On September 9th, the Hopkinton Center for the Arts hosted their Celebrity Concert Series. This is their largest fundraiser, and this year they hosted the legendary John Oates. The event was a tremendous success, raising more than $73,000 to support the HCA and their mission to make the arts accessible to all. Welcome to Driven, the show where we meet interesting and accomplished people and explore why they do what they do. Today, we sit down with a musical legend who needs no introduction. He is one half of the iconic duo Hall & Oates, a singer-songwriter with a career that spans decades, and a true pioneer in the world of rock and pop. He has sold more than 80 million albums worldwide and was inducted into the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame and the Songwriters Hall of Fame. Oates came of age in the 1970s, and he lived the height of excess through the 1980s. But after 17 years of nearly constant writing, recording, and touring, he and Hall decided to take a break in 1987, and that would be the last time he recorded until 2002. In spite of his remarkable success, Oates remains utterly unpretentious and completely down to earth. He is a true musician's musician. Where he plays doesn't matter. It's about creating a connection with his audience and bringing them on a musical journey through some of the most timeless songs in history. For me, it was the drums. Okay, the first time I saw a drum set, I had to play it. I was 10 years old. For you, it was the guitar.
Yes.
Describe the first time that you saw a guitar and just had that feeling.
Well, I grew up in a small town in Pennsylvania, and the only music teacher in that town was an accordion teacher. So my mom, recognizing I had some sort of early musical talent, gave me accordion lessons, and of course I hated every minute of it, and I never practiced, and after about 3 weeks the teacher said, I don't think he wants to play the accordion. My mom said, you don't want to play the accordion? I said, no. I said, I want to play the guitar like Elvis. So it was kind of, it was the early days of rock and roll. It was the early 50s, and I wanted to, you know, wanted to play guitar. And luckily, a very good friend of mine lived down the street from me. His father was a woodworker and had handmade a guitar on his own as just an experiment. And he gave it to me, and I took my first few lessons on that guitar. And I still have that guitar.
So you and Daryl, when you got together, you both had bands.
Yeah, we had separate groups, that's right.
And so where and how did you first meet?
Well, I was aware of his group, and he was aware of me because we both had singles out in the Philadelphia area being played on the Philadelphia R&B stations. So we were both individually, both groups were individually invited to go to what was in those days known as a record hop, which was basically a teenage dance run by a DJ. And we showed up, and there was a giant gang fight, and we ran out of the backstage door onto the street. And that's how we met. And my group was about ready to really fold. And I joined Daryl's group as a backup guitar player initially. That group fell apart, and he and I just gravitated towards each other.
Yeah, and you spent some time in Europe too. It sounded like kind of really discovering a little bit about who you were. What kind of influence did that have on you as a young person?
Well, it was a dream of mine. My parents, my mother's side is from Italy. My father's father was English. And so I wanted to experience Europe. I had never been. So the moment I graduated from college, I sold everything I owned, which wasn't much. Scraped up enough cash to go with a backpack and a guitar, and I spent 4 months busking around Europe. And when I got back, the funny part about it is that while I was away, I had sublet my apartment in Philadelphia to Daryl's sister and her boyfriend, and they evidently didn't pay the rent because when I got back, there was a padlock on the door. So I wandered down the road to where Daryl was living at the time, and I said, "Hey, I'm back, and I've got no place to live." And he said, "Oh, you can stay here." And so I just went up into a little bedroom where his piano happened to be, and it was a fold-out couch, and I slept on that. And he would come up and play piano, and I started playing guitar, and we just started writing songs together.
Well, and that's like that zero-hour moment,
yeah.
Where, you know, she didn't pay the rent. There's a padlock on the door. You're like, I need a couch.
Exactly. We didn't plan it. It just happened.
So a lot of your fans came to you in the 80s, mm-hmm. But you guys had been writing and playing since 1970.
Yeah.
So when you look back, what was that sort of wow, we've really made it moment?
You know, people ask that question all the time. I can be honest and say there's it's incremental. It's what it's what you need and what you're focused on at the moment. The first step was to play together. The second step was to write some songs. The third step was to get a record contract. then to go on the road. And each one of those things were pivotal moments, you know, and it kind of built upon it, that's how you build a career. And then, of course, you know, as our career, you know, as we became more well-known and we had more popularity and success, then it's, you know, it's playing Madison Square Garden. It's playing, you know, we played Live Aid, the original Live Aid, the first time you go to Tokyo or London or something like that. So it's all those little things, but they're all little big things.
I listen to your music now, and I listen to Hall & Oates. The one thing that stands out for me are the intros, okay? So Sarah Smile, Maneater, Rich Girl, anyone watching this, the second that I say those, they know those intros. And they know it from the very first minute. Even Arkansas, I know it from the first moment the mandolin comes in. Wow. That's Arkansas. Was that an intentional part of your writing, or is it just something that, I mean, you can write a hook like no one else.
I've never thought about it, but I guess, you know, if you want to suck someone into a song, you better have a good intro. That's a good start.
It's unbelievable. Right? And the testament to that is that you have some of the most sampled songs.
We do. It's true.
Ever. I mean, yeah. So many R&B artists today have sampled, you know, Maneater and songs like that. That's the sign of a good hook.
Yes, it is. And it's also the sign of a well-crafted song, because a well-crafted song can be interpreted in a lot of ways, you know, and that's what happens to our music. I get requests for licenses, you know, multiple times a week. Someone will do a version of Out of Touch, and they'll change a little bit of it, and you know, we get to approve all these, you know, various samples and licenses. Sometimes it's an actual just license to use the song in a TV commercial or a movie. Maneater was just used in that new Jennifer Lawrence movie, which was a big, big hit. So, yeah, that happens all the time. It's here again, it's all about the songs.
So video killed the radio star, but not you.
Well, no.
So how is it? You guys had already kind of embraced that medium going way back before it was even a thing, because you had cameras around recording you.
Yeah.
And you guys were kind of experimenting. What do you think you guys kind of hit that moment right at the same time MTV was coming up, and instead of falling to the side like so many bands did, you were superstars at that point.
Well, we were, being the way we look so different, Daryl being tall and blonde, me being short and dark, we were visually interesting, I guess. But really what happened was we were friends with the folks who started MTV. And they came to us and they said, hey, we're going to do a video music channel. And we're like, what's a video music channel? Because there had obviously had never been done before. And they said, well, we're just going to show music videos. You go and lip sync your song or whatever it is you want to do. My initial reaction was that what a great way to promote ourselves around the world without physically being there. And I didn't really think of it as an artistic medium or as a medium to create. At first, it was really just, for me, that's how I thought of it. And obviously when people like Madonna came and Michael Jackson, obviously music videos took on an entirely, you know.
They became their own art form.
Exactly, they became their own art form, well put. And you know, then we of course, you know, the budgets went up and the video extravaganza began on MTV. But in the beginning, if you look at the early videos, our Private Eyes video was the first one we did. It's just us jumping around in funny clothes in front of a black screen.
You're skipping to the end because I do have a question for Out of Touch.
Yeah.
Okay.
Oh, yeah.
That was an epic video.
That was epic.
All right.
Yeah.
You do a cartwheel in that. A slow motion cartwheel.
Thank you very much.
Here's
that
my question.
Really good,
do you still
nice.
Do all your
oh,
own
yeah.
stunts?
I'm going to be doing cartwheels tonight.
Oh, we can't wait to see that.
Oh,
that's amazing.
Have you ever seen anyone do a cartwheel with an acoustic guitar?
No, but I'm looking forward
while
to it.
While they're playing folk music?
No.
All at the same
it's
time?
It's going to be great.
Oh, yeah. That's what I do.
So take me back for a minute. You mentioned Live Aid. So you and Daryl, you closed the Philadelphia show.
Yeah.
Okay. You're playing in front of 90,000 people and another 2 billion watching live. I mean, I don't even have a question. It's just, wow.
It was the first time a music event had been simulcast around the world. It was in the early, early days of cable TV. You know, it really was a very, very pivotal moment in rock and roll history. Mick Jagger had done a solo album, and of course he wasn't playing with the Stones, so he asked us to be his backup band, which was a great, you know, a great honor and privilege. And we knew that he was going to bring out Tina Turner, but we didn't know he was going to rip her skirt off, which I thought was
which
fun.
Was iconic, iconic moment.
Yeah, it was exciting, and we also had David Ruffin and Eddie Kendrick, the two lead singers from the Temptations,
absolutely,
who were our idols,
yep,
and who we did the Apollo Theater show with prior to that.
Yes.
So really, we got a chance to pay homage to our teenage idols, the Temptations, and play with Mick and Tina Turner. So yeah, it was amazing.
So 1985. You're at the height of your success.
Right.
And then you decide to take a break.
Yeah.
You looked at each other and said, I mean, where do we go from here? We Are the World, Live Aid, I mean.
That's exactly what happened. We had done We Are the World, we had done Live Aid, we had been touring the world constantly. We had multiple number one records. We really felt that there was no, the end game was that there's only, you only can go down from there. It was almost impossible to go up from there. And so it wasn't really a commercially motivated decision. It was more of, we just wanted to step out for a second. And, you know, obviously from a commercial point of view, from a career point of view, it probably wasn't a very good idea. But nevertheless, it enabled us to continue. And I think we might have gotten, cast aside as 80s relics.
I was just going to say, you just said that maybe it wasn't a good decision, but I'm not sure I agree with that, because if you look at what happened in the 90s, mm-hmm, okay, and you write about this in your book about, yeah, you know, there was sort of a to hell with it all kind of.
It was a grunge movement.
Yeah.
It was a garage band grunge movement, which we didn't fit in. We would have not fit in if we were still trying to compete on the radio at that time. So yes, in a way, you know, we didn't of course know that was going to happen, but it worked out that way. And as the 90s progressed, we kind of laid low, and then we began to consider recording, and we went back to touring, and then our touring business got even bigger than it was before.
So across every album and album cover and every headshot, your look ranges from serious to pensive to inquisitive.
To ridiculous? You forgot to add that part.
And yet you're smiling here. Why don't you smile? Why didn't you smile in your pictures?
I don't know. Maybe I wasn't very happy. I don't know. Maybe I had this image of myself that I should be like tough and serious, you know. And I'm not at all like that. I don't know. Who knows? You know, maybe I had a
you had a look.
Maybe I had a deep-seated anger that I'm only now able to exercise.
I don't buy it. I think you had a look, and that was your brand, and it worked for you. But
I
noticed that
it was my look. It was my brand.
It was your brand.
Well, I have a new brand now.
So yeah, this is the kindler, gentler John.
The happier John.
The happier John.
Yes.
So you have played some of the largest stadiums in the world. I mean, we talked about that, and you've also played some of the most storied. Like just last week, you were at the Grand Ole Opry,
mm-hmm,
which is amazing, and I would love to hear about that. Mm-hmm. What is it that you enjoy about playing more intimate venues like Hopkinton Center for the Arts?
I love being able to interact with people and really see them, and really there's an excitement and an energy level that happens in a big arena or a stadium that you can't compare anything else to. It's very, very exciting. But then for me, I love to be able to tell stories. I love to be able to get, you know, an immediate reaction from people, and I love to play venues that are made for music. That, you know, especially old theaters. I play a lot of old theaters around the country that were built, you know, sometimes, you know, turn of the century, some even in as early as the 1800s. And there's a thing about these theaters. They have a history and a feel to them that I love. So that's what I do. I love doing this type of show. I get a chance to really stretch out on guitar. I get to really play a lot of things that people really don't expect, and this show is I think surprises a lot of people. But in the end, I try to take them on a musical journey, so to speak.
Yeah, I've noticed. I've watched some of your other shows, and I've noticed that you do a little bit of storytelling before the songs too, which I think is great. You know, it's not a show up and throw up. I'm just going to play a bunch of songs. It's, you know, you're like, let me tell you the story, the genesis of how I wrote this song. I mean, you do a lot of that in your shows, which is really great.
The hits always, you know, obviously people know the hits and they want to hear some of those, and that's fine. But I want to play a lot of my new music, because all songwriters always want to play their new music, and you have to temper that desire with the desire to be professional and give people somewhat what they might expect. What I learned in doing this show was that if I set up a song with the backstory and give a little context to the new music that they've never heard before, They hear the song in a different, completely different way.
That's a great insight.
They hear the song as though they know it. It's really interesting how it's worked. And I've been refining and working through that in the show tonight. You'll see that in the show tonight.
Last question.
Yeah.
If heaven exists, what would you like to hear God say when you arrive, St. Peter say, when you arrive at the pearly gates?
That you treated people well, and you were a good dad, and you were honest.
Thanks for your time today.
Thank you. That was a nice interview.